Hello, I'm Jamie Wyver from the RSPB's Notes on Nature team. And for this video, I'm joined by May Duek from the Wildlife Inquiries team. Hello, May.
Hiya.
And we are going to be looking at some of the most popular questions we get asked in January. Unsurprisingly, the first one of those is about the Big Garden Birdwatch that we run every year. Now, May, what kind of questions do people ask about that?
So the top question that we get is when people are concerned about not being able to participate because they don't have a garden. But actually, you don't need a garden to participate in the Birdwatch. You can do it anywhere that you can just see some birds. So that could be your local park, any sort of green space that you have around, or even your balcony, and especially if you've got feeders around.
And I've done that myself when I've lived in flats, sort of. One year, I remember living in a flat, looking out the window and seeing the green space I could see below me. And another year, I went to a local park and just sort of looked at an area that was within a distance that I could clearly see what the birds were. And that's quite important, isn't it, to define that area?
Exactly. That's a very good point. You have to, especially if you're doing it in a really large area, you should define the area that you're going to watch. Because you'll only be counting the birds that land in the area that you're watching. So it's important to sort of create like a patch for yourself. You can do that by using like the trees or like hedges and like figuring out what kind of area you're going to watch. That makes it a lot easier to sort of count the birds that actually land in your sort of patch. And like defining the space is also really important because sometimes if you pick a really large space, then you might have some trouble identifying birds from far away. So if you're looking at a particular area, that also makes counting a lot easier. If some areas are really busy, then, you're not sure how to count the birds sometimes. It's best to count the highest number of individuals for each species that you see. So if a species lands, like say one bird lands and then goes off, and then two more of the same species come, so say like two more blue tits come, and then they fly off, and then five more come, and then instead of adding it up, you just count the highest number. So that would be five in this case. And it makes it a lot easier to do that, when you've got the area defined.
It really does. And the point with Big Garden Birdwatch as well is that you shouldn't have to use binoculars. I mean, you might want to, but you shouldn't need to for this, should you?
Exactly, yeah. I personally really like watching from the safety of my own home and just watching from the window. If you've got feeders and things like that, that really works well. So yeah, I really like doing that.
And how about weather? Should we worry if we're going to get really bad weather on the day that we want to do it?
Not at all. So this is actually a very common question as well. So a lot of people are worried that because of the weather is like unusual, or if it's particularly bad, that they're not going to get any birds, but it's not a problem. We get so many participants from all across the country that it doesn't matter if you see a particularly low number of birds. It's all going to even themselves out. So another thing people concern is time of day, because sometimes people notice that birds come a lot more often in the mornings and sort of just before dusk, and maybe not as much in the middle of the day. But it doesn't matter. You can do it any time of the day in any weather. And because of the way we sort of analyze the data, it all even themselves out.
What's the next question we've got? Because this is another thing about attracting birds, isn't it?
Yeah, so obviously when people want to participate in the Garden Bird Watch, they want to attract lots of birds to their garden. And coming from autumn, so some people who've observed sort of lack of birds in their garden make that extra effort on making, their garden attractive to birds and also helping them out during the cold weather. So first and foremost, providing natural food sources and shelter is the most important. But during winter, offering food is really valuable for the birds as well. So the ground sort of starts to freeze and they can't get to all the worms on the ground, and the natural food sort of diminish. So garden food becomes really important. Around this time, suet is a really good product. Robins and starlings absolutely love fat balls. And all that. You can get so many different kinds of suet products. I really like sprinkles. I find that when I put them in like a tray, like a window feeder or a bird table, birds will come and pick them and then fly off with them. And then they'll sort of eat it in the safety of the trees. And it works really well for species that don't want to spend a lot of time on the feeder itself.
And it's all about making that food easy, isn't it? So it's about making that food easy to come in, grab in as safely as possible, and then eat or take away again quickly. So it's maximizing the kind of opportunity for a bird to come in and get something that's going to give them fat, that's going to give them nutrition, without taking up too much of their time.
Exactly, yeah, because the most attractive part of garden food is that it's really easy and really accessible to birds. They don't have to work really hard to get to the food, so the easier to get, the better. Things like sunflower hearts are also really easy because they come in small bites. They can just fly off with them. Some birds eat it on the feeder, some sort of fly off with it. But that's also something that's really rich in oils and fat, so they provide a lot of nutrition and the much needed warmth for the birds.
Much needed at this time of year, of course. And then something else about this time of year is that you expect birds to be quiet. You might expect a little bit of chattering, a bit of starling, squabbling around the bird feeder, but you don't expect birds to be singing. But some are, aren't they?
Definitely, yeah. So we often get calls about birds singing and sort of why they're singing in, especially if they're singing sort of at night or when it's a lot darker. And usually the culprit here are robins. They're one of the species that sing all year round because they defend their territories all year round. And they also get triggered in the song really easily. So even the lowest amount of light can trigger them into song. So they're one of the first starters of the day. So they start singing the first and then they also finish the last. So they have a really long period that they sing. And they also get sort of disturbed in the night very easily. So if there's, say, something like street lighting or lightning, that source of light also wakes them up and then they start singing. And the same could happen with lots of things. So if they're roosting on a tree and this tree shakes because of something like high winds, that also triggers them into song. And so they sing a big portion of the day and a big portion of the year. And so people get confused by it a lot.
Definitely. Now, what's the next question we've got?
So we also get questions about activity at nest boxes. So because it's winter, people don't expect nesting activity to start, which is fair. But a lot of birds sort of like to be ahead of the game and start preparing really early on. Blue tits and starlings are one of the most common ones that do this. So blue tits will start inspecting boxes. They'll start picking where they want to nest, even if they don't start nesting immediately. So there's a couple of things that they do to like prepare the box. So they'll test the integrity of the box, see if it's strong enough by like tapping at it. They'll also start cleaning out any old remaining materials. So a lot of people clean out nest boxes, which is excellent. But if they don't, then the blue tits, any other birds, will take out the old nest, any sort of materials that might have accumulated there. They'll just get everything ready for the spring. And something that catches people's eye is sometimes they'll peck around the hole. And this is really confusing to some because they think it's because the bird can't fit in it. So they think, oh, is the hole too small? Did it get too fat in Christmas? But no, it's fine. It's just that it's marking the hole to sort of mark the box as claimed. So it's like putting like a sold sign out of it. So yeah, starlings and blue tits love to do that. And it's just sort of claiming their own nest box. And then sometimes they go off and they don't really do much else there. It's just sort of preparing it for spring.
There's some lovely parallels with people, isn't there? There's sort of a bit of a surveyor going into a house and checking its integrity and them coming in and doing the sort of interior design. Like you said, the for sale sign. Really, really interesting behavior to observe.
Exactly, yeah. So then they get everything ready and then they go off and then they prepare themselves to move in the spring and then they come.
Now, as well as those blue tits and other birds that are prospecting nest boxes, there are some birds that do nest surprisingly early in the year, aren't there?
Exactly. So some birds don't have to wait until March to start nesting. So they nest a lot earlier than the others. So things like grey herons, for example, and like rooks, they nest quite early. And grey herons especially, they arrive to their nesting sites to sort of prepare as well. So you might see them arriving in their nesting locations a lot earlier than you might expect. So tawny owls also nest a lot earlier in the year. So yeah, not all wait until sort of spring.
And those are some great sights and sounds to be aware of in the countryside. Birds flying to and fro with twigs, the noise of a heronry. I mean, that's quite an experience in itself. And rooks calling and tawny owls marking their territory. Great things to experience at this time of year.
Exactly. So keep your eyes out if you go out into the countryside.
We've got one last question here, and this is about an unusual bird that people spot in their garden and they call you to say, what on earth is this?
Yeah, exactly. So this bird is a black cap. It's always tricky to sort of guess birds, like identify them from descriptions, especially like if it's over the phone and people can't really show you the bird. But black cap is one of the ones that it's pretty easy to identify if people had a good look at it. It's mostly because people describe the birds as it was wearing a hat. And when people say that, we immediately know it's a black cap. So as the name suggests, the males have like a black, like solid black on the top of their head. But females look a bit different. They have like a reddish brown cap. So the cap is like the same. It's just the color that's different. And the females are also a bit more on the brown side. And the males are just gray sort of all over. They have a more grayish tone. Their underparts also are a bit grayer, and their backs, like upper parts, are also a bit browner for both species. But yeah, these are really lovely birds. They're actually warblers.
They are, and they're quite small, aren't they? So it's about the size of a robin, a little bit smaller?
Yeah, something like that, yeah. With regards to sort of it being a warbler, they're one of the larger warblers. Most of the other warblers are smaller than them, but yeah, they're about that size. And most people don't actually expect them to be in the UK during winter. So warblers, most warblers are summer visitors. So when people see them, they don't really expect to see a warbler in their garden during winter. But actually one of the things that attracts them to the UK during winter is people offering a lot of food in their garden. So we think that because people have been putting out so much food, that makes them, that makes the UK a lot more livable for them for winter.
And what do they eat in winter? Because presumably in summer, other warblers, they'll be eating insects, but in winter, they'll change their diet a bit, won't they?
Exactly, yeah. So they'll eat things like seeds. So sunflower hearts, which are loved by all, are also loved by black caps too. So they'll eat things like that. So that kind of food, like seeds, will be fine for them. And so they'll love any kind of like seed mix that you put out.
Lovely. And just a final thought on black caps. Tell me if I've got this wrong, but do the black caps that spend the summer here fly south across Europe and Africa, and some of the ones that we might see in winter in our gardens, they've come from elsewhere, haven't they?
Exactly. So they're not the same ones. So they're sort of migratory birds, and they switch locations to breed and to winter. So the ones that breed here during summer spend winters in like somewhere warmer, like Spain or North Africa. But the ones that we get here during winter have actually been shown to come from Germany, or like Central Europe in general. So it's shown that they breed in Germany and come here for winter. So it's not the same sort of population that you're seeing summer and winter. They don't just stay. It's just that a different flock comes in from Germany. Yeah.
Absolutely fascinating. You never know what's going to turn up in your garden or local green space. So do keep your eye out there. May, thank you so much for answering all these questions. And thank you all for watching.
Thank you.